You're going to see the trailer for a film called Beyond the Lights. Universal had the rights to the film. They were going to distribute it on home release only, so iTunes, Amazon, DVD, but not theatrically. So this film was not going to get a theatrical release. And so I just want to kind of invite you to think about what your assumptions are about this kind of film and whether it would have an audience. Do you think it would sell? If you're a programmer in a regional cinema, do you think you could sell this film based on the trailer in your cinema? And just, yeah, watch it and think, would people watch this? Does it make sense to send this film straight to DVD based on the trailer?
Why you wanna fly, blackbird? You ain't ever gonna fly. Why you wanna fly?
You wanna be a runner-up? You wanna be a winner?
You ain't ever gonna fly. No place big enough for home.
Noni is supposed to be the girl that every guy wants.
We're selling fantasy here.
All right, let's lose the jacket.
Cause your mama's name was Noni.
Everybody says I'm special because I have this voice. But I'm just saying what everybody else wants me to say.
Can you look at me for a second?
No, wait! Hey, look at me!
I see you.
It's in the moments when you're left all on your own.
And that night on the balcony, you were screaming, I see you. So, just what do you see?
Don't be scared.
Just need to see it for a second.
Then go wait at the curb with the rest of the groupies.
What's your name?
Kaz. Short for Kazam.
No.
Yeah, my parents thought it sounded African.
You busy?
What's all this?
Lyrics. No one cares what I have to say.
I'm listening.
It's your life. Don't throw it away. This is different.
You didn't meet in a church pew, son.
Church girls are the ones you gotta watch out for.
Cause I hear you loud as a bomb, wanting a shoulder to
I don't know how to play this game, Muse.
Here and now, you're afraid.
This thing?
It's not good for her. You throw off her game.
All right, metaphor.
I'll teach you to fly before.
When did you ever tell me that you didn't want this? When I was on that balcony.
I need you.
Don't you worry.
You need me.
I'll teach you to fly before you fall away.
So, it's weird, huh? That something that seems to me to have such obvious mainstream appeal. It's a melodrama, it's a romance, it's a music film, it's glossy, it's Hollywood. The director, Gina Fitzbythewood, is the director of a film called Love and Basketball, which many people will have seen. So kind of going into the press screening of this, I'm primarily a journalist, and so I turned up to Universal's private screening rooms, and I was the only journalist there. It was an unusual situation. I've never kind of experienced anything like it, to be the only person in a press room watching this film. And I said to them, you know, is anyone else coming? And they said, no, like nobody else has turned up, but you're here, so we might as well put it on. And so I had this extremely surreal experience of sitting in this dark room by myself. And actually, I was overwhelmed by how much I enjoyed the film. And there was something just so kind of corny and joyful about it. And I came out of it and I thought, okay, why is this going straight to DVD? Why is there no controversy around it? Why haven't I heard about this? And a friend of mine, Karina Antrobus, she set up the Bechdel Test Fest. So the Bechdel Test for anyone who doesn't know, for a film to pass it, it has to have two women, both have a name, talk about something other than a man. That's all. And an amazing amount of films don't pass it. And the artist who kind of devised this rule in the form of a comic book called The Rule Alison Bechdel, that's what Tess is named after. So Karina had this festival that was in existence, and as it luckily turns out, she had already been kind of thinking she might want to screen this film. So I came out of the screening and I called her immediately and I said, Karina, you know, we've got to show this. We should work together on this. This needs to be seen. And thus began a long and ultimately successful but quite challenging battle with the distributor, Universal, because essentially we're a very small kind of non-profit festival, and so for them to entrust us to put on a screening of this when they decided that they weren't going to do any theatrical screenings. The only other theatrical screening was at the Edinburgh International Film Festival, and that was, I think, one or two one-off screenings. So to try and convince them that, yes, actually, we could show this and we could pack out a cinema, that was what we really wanted to do. And the other interesting thing about this film is that the lead actress, Gugu Mbatha-Raw, and I guess Minnie Driver, are both Brits, and part of the film is set in Brixton. So it was, again, odd that there seemed to be this sort of pre-made audience, and yet there was a total reluctance to engage with that audience on the part of the distributors or the marketers. So in terms of thinking, okay, we've got to get the rights to this film, we've got to show it, we were also thinking, how can we create a conversation around it? And as I said to you before, I was totally, totally shocked that nobody had been writing about this. So I thought, okay, well, that's what I do. How can I intervene and start a conversation about this? And I ended up writing an article for BuzzFeed, of all places, but I did take it to a few publications, and only after that BuzzFeed article came out, with the exception of one piece by Robbie Collin at The Telegraph, none of the nationals had really been interested in it. And so it was basically, I think, why Gemma wanted me to speak about this is because my approach was two-pronged. It was, how do I start a conversation? And then how do I pull that conversation off the screen, or off the computer screen, and kind of put it in a cinema space? And that's essentially what happened. We did drum up a lot of press, and you know, sort of through word of mouth as well, we spread the word about this film. We got the Ritzy involved, because we knew we wanted to screen it in Brixton. The Ritzy were really amazing. Paul Ridd and Claire Binns from Picture House were very supportive very early on, and they did a lot of the negotiating on our behalf. And it was really about collaboration and how could we work with organisations that had more power than us without kind of sacrificing our own power or identity. But that's the main thing that we all learned, that it's all about good relations. You don't need to have access or money necessarily, you just need to sort of have an idea and be able to present it clearly and be able to engage with the right people.
And I just wanted to ask you a couple of questions.
Yeah.
I've been thinking about just playing devil's advocate. Do you think that Universal should care about this audience, and why do you think they didn't?
There's two different questions, and I'll start with the why I don't think they did care, and I think it's just financial reasons. The film didn't do particularly well in the States in terms of making money, but it was also very poorly marketed and released at a time where it was never going to do well. It was always going to be a smaller film, kind of lost in the awards season kind of glut of prestige films. It wasn't given a chance from a marketing perspective, so why would that translate over here? And similarly, the UK doesn't have a great precedent for black films doing brilliantly in terms of ticket sales and audience attendance. So I think if they were going to believe in this film, then they would also have to back that up with a lot of kind of care and attention in terms of marketing it and reaching diverse audiences. So realistically, that takes money, time, attention, and for a film that's not really gonna make that money back, what's the incentive other than goodwill? And I think perhaps, and this is something that I kind of wrote about as well, Universal was not, it's not necessarily their fault, but they perhaps weren't the right people to handle this film. Perhaps an independent distributor might have, or a smaller distributor might have been able to give it more care and more attention, and it would have done better in that way. And I guess that's why something like Bechdel Test Fest is an interesting alternative way of showing this film, because essentially the power is taken from the distributor and to the exhibitor, and so we're doing the marketing for them and driving the ticket sales, etc. Like, that's not something that they have to do, they're outsourcing that to us. In terms of, do I think it's their responsibility to do so? Yes and no. I think, of course, like, a mainstream distributor can't just ignore people of colour who are going to watch their other films, and there's this feeling that that people don't want to, well, it's not a feeling, it's an assumption, that people don't want to engage with stories that aren't about themselves, and I actually don't find that to be true at all. And this screening that we put on, we actually ended up putting on two screenings because we sold out the first one, and Picture House was so pleased with how it had gone, they offered us a second screening. And it was supported by Film Hub London, so we got a little bit of money to do it, and part of the deal with that is that you have to do some diversity reporting, which is really interesting for us as we're kind of a new festival trying to grow our audience. We get to look at the breakdown of where the people who go to our screenings, where they live, how old they are, what's their gender, what's their sexuality, what's their ethnicity, what's their age, oh, I already said that, and kind of looking at that breakdown is surprisingly spread out. There were almost 50-50 in terms of gender. It is very racially diverse. There were older people, there were younger people. So it was interesting to see how once you kind of believe in the power of the film and in the power of your own marketing, you can actually reach a really wide variety of people.
And I think one of the things that I find interesting about kind of that the sort of exhibition intervention is the level of risk that as an independent cinema or as a film club, obviously there are different levels of risk for each, but in comparison to the level of risk, or, well, it's not even, risk is not even the right word, but the lack of return that Universal would get. You know, Universal as a distributor year has had, this year has had the most lucrative year ever, and they've ditched three films, passed them off to someone else or sent them straight to DVD. And two other films were the Kurt Cobain doc, which ended up getting released by a smaller distributor, and the other one was Northern Soul. And Northern Soul did so well, like, it did incredibly well in cinemas in our independent sector as well, but it just wasn't good enough for Universal, like the measure of success. It's kind of like how we ended the last session was, you know, different people will measure success differently, and the remit will be different for each person. So the cultural remit is absolutely what is obviously motivating you all in this room, but for Universal it was about return. And I think the value of Beyond the Lights, I mean, talk about some of the reactions maybe, because it was very, it was quite personally about a mixed race identity as well, wasn't it? About seeing that on screen and not having seen that.
Yeah, I mean, Karina, who's the Bechdel Test Fest director, she wrote a really beautiful piece in the Huffington Post about how she, as a mixed race girl, connected with this story. And the opening scene is set in Brixton, and it's got Minnie Driver, a single mum, a white mum, with her mixed race daughter, taking her to the hairdressers and saying to the black hairdresser, "What do I do with her hair?" And you know, Karina, and I'm sure other mixed race people who might have seen the film, you know, related to that. And Karina actually said to me, "I've never seen that before. I've never seen that specific struggle on screen." And it's 2015. It's kind of crazy. So just little moments, it doesn't have to be the overarching politics of a film, or it doesn't have to be particularly schematic or or didactic or political or academic or any of these things that we might expect from a quote-unquote black film. But it's just what Gemma was saying earlier about seeing yourself represented or seeing somebody who looks like you on screen or seeing a story that is slightly different, has a different entry point, that's valuable in and of itself.